Just ahead on American Black Journal, we've got a conversation with Motown founder Berry Gordy, and we have cast members from Motown the Musical here. Plus, a look at efforts to raise awareness about human trafficking. Stay right there. American Black Journal starts now.
American Black Journal is funded by the W.K. Kellogg Foundation, a partner with communities where children come first.
How does diversity bring energy to us all? At DTE Energy, we believe that it's the contributions of all that build great communities. As a company, we grow stronger by welcoming the unique perspectives of everyone. As community members, we support our state's broad culture and heritage. From working closely with women and minority-owned suppliers to embracing our local cultures, DTE Energy is powering diversity. The DTE Energy Foundation is a proud sponsor of Detroit Public Television. Masco Corporation is proud to manufacture innovative and environmentally friendly products for the home. Delta Faucets, Craft Made in Maryland Cabinets, and Bear Brand Paints have all been designed with you in mind. Masco and its family of companies, serving Michigan communities since 1929.
Welcome to American Black Journal. I'm Stephen Henderson. Motown the Musical tells the true American dream story of legendary Motown founder Berry Gordy. The popular production has returned to Detroit for 2 weeks at the Fisher Theater. American Black Journal's Chastity Pratt Dossey caught up with Berry Gordy and the actor who portrays him in the musical, Chester Gregory, at the Motown Museum.
Here in Detroit, for the musical and so many other things, I was reading from your autobiography, To Be Real, which you wrote back in 1994, partly to dispel some of the myths about Motown and tell the truth. I'm wondering, with this musical, how accurate is it? What did you put in? What did you leave out? How truthful is it?
Too truthful, for my sake. You know, we just kind of told it. See, first of all, you know, it's like telling. It's very easy, and I tell people that I work with, you know, artists is coming in. When they come in, I tell them, you know, just tell the truth and make it entertaining. That's all you have to do. It's not that complicated. You tell the truth and make it entertaining. But people so busy trying to make things seem like they were, and they get caught up into this doesn't, and an audience sits and looks at that and said, this doesn't feel right. It doesn't feel right. They just did this over here and they did this over here. So what we do at Motown is about tell the truth and make it interesting. It's not much more complicated than that. And if the truth of your life is not a good one, then that will show. And if it was a good one, that will show. You had trials and tribulations, that will show. You know, it's just about, and I tell the kids when they come in, you know, with whoever it be, Smokey, Michael, Marvin Gaye, this one, that one, tell your truth. And those guys believed it so much that they became interesting all the time. In fact, me and Marvin would fight all the time because his truth was very narrow.
I mean, are those types of things in the play? What you know,
yes,
just generally
everything
speaking.
I'm saying, the truth is, it has to be there because it's the truth, you know. Even embarrassing moments, I've had a couple, and it happened to be true, and people say, you're not going to put this in there. I said, no, it's true. You know, if I can make it interesting, I will, but I got to, because people relate to that. They relate to the truth, and that's why I fought so hard to get my music heard by everybody. You know, and the disc jockeys would not play black music on white stations because it wasn't popular. They had a pop station. You with the R&B and black music and race music.
Right.
And I said, no, I'm not. I'm with people music. I'm you know, it's you know, white people would love my stuff if they could hear it because it's about them too.
Chester Gregory, you play Berry Gordy on stage, and I'm from Detroit, and I would venture to say nobody knows Motown like Motown knows Motown, right? A lot of these artists actually walked it through and lived in our neighborhoods, and now you're doing this story here for a Detroit audience. Talk to me about what's performance-wise, fresh and new that even Detroiters can learn and enjoy in this story?
I think one thing that I love about being a part of this musical and working with Mr. Gordy is that he allows us to interpret the characters and the truth of the story in an honest way to us. So it's not people up there doing impersonations or anything like that. We're honoring these legends in a way that is truthful to us as actors. So I think that because there is no place in the world that will look at this under a greater microscope than Detroit.
You got that right.
Right? Right. So it's not just legends. These are like family members, people they grew up with. Mm-hmm. They know all kinds of backstories and stuff like that. So no one can compete with that. But what they will discover is a way, what they will discover is a way for me to portray him in a way that's honest to me and what that means to me. Nobody else can touch that. And so for me to instill that and then spread that, then I think that will be something that will leave people with a fresh perspective on something that they have known about their entire life.
Now, Mr. Gordy, I think some people would be intrigued to know that when you started Motown, you kind of employed some of the methods that you learned on the assembly line. You turned this into a hit factory, right? I wonder, though, you know, 180 number one songs later and all these legendary accomplishments, when you look at today's music industry, you got online, you got digital, you got social media. Could a Motown have happened, or can a Motown happen in today's industry, or was it something that belonged to that time and place?
Well, everything has its time and its place and its world circumstances. Mm-hmm. And today's music is a product of that fact that so there's social media, there's streaming, there's this, there's that.
Right.
Any kid with a cell phone can become a record company, you know,
right,
because they can write their songs, they can do their movies, they can do their everything. So it's a different time. So, but there are certain things that remain that people must have in any time. And so when you ask me what today's time is, you know, everybody around the world and China can come up with a song and
right,
it can go international. So you can't say, what would you do in today's time?
Could we have a Motown today? You know, can a Motown type of thing happen in this industry, or is it?
Well, yes, a Motown thing can always happen because it's built on love. It's built on love and truth. So if there's love and truth involved, and all you have to do is make it entertaining, it can happen anytime. So content is still the same. We still have to have hit content. It's just that there's so many more technology and this and that and so forth. So a lot of content that come out is not a hit, but it's a hit because it is heard so many times over media, or is this or is that. But still, content is the name of the game.
Okay, no surprise, Berry Gordy had a lot more to say in that interview, so you can watch the entire thing at AmericanBlackJournal.org. And joining me now are two cast members from Motown the Musical. Allison Sims plays Diana Ross, and Elijah Ahmad Lewis portrays Stevie Wonder. Welcome, both of you, to American Black Journal.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, no. Definitely. So, no pressure on you guys at all. Playing Diana Ross, playing Stevie Wonder, doing it in Detroit, I'm sure it's nothing, right? You just go out there every day
no
and turn it on, right?
Exactly, no. But it's really great because it really does feel like a homecoming in a sense.
Yeah.
You know, this is where it all started. Mm-hmm. Motown is in Motown. So, you know, it's all love. It's, you know, it's definitely pressure, but
yeah,
it's all love.
Yeah. Yeah, we heard in the video Chesty asking about performing this in Detroit, where, you know, if you get it wrong, you're going to hear about it, and you're going to hear about it during the performance, right?
Mm-hmm.
Someone from the audience is going to say, that's not right. That's mm-hmm. not how that happened. Talk about the response you've gotten, though, from Detroiters that may be different from other cities.
They're so into this show. I mean, you know, going around from different cities, you know, being that Motown music is the soundtrack to the American life. And I can say that with confidence.
Yes, right.
You know, so they know everything that happened. They know what happened with these artists. They followed these artists. But, you know, back here in Detroit, they lived this.
Yes.
You know, we have dressers at the theater who were like, oh, I was singing back up with the Vandellas. You know, I hear that tambourine, that was me.
Right.
You know, this is the life that they lived. So it's almost not just an American soundtrack, but an American life story.
Yeah.
Because you can sit in the audience and say, I remember when that happened, I was at Tina's house down the street, and then I came down and they were doing My Girl.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
So of course we're telling Detroit's story also.
Yeah. The story here is of course about Berry Gordy and the way he sort of goes from the beginnings of this through the thing, but it also tells the story of these artists, and you guys are playing artists who have, I think, two of the most compelling stories out of Motown. Talk about getting into that character. Diana Ross grows up in a housing project here, mm-hmm. goes to Cass Tech with my mother,
yes.
of course, one of those Motown stories, right?
Yes.
But then becomes the biggest star in the world. Talk about that character.
Yeah, you know, what I love about playing Diana Ross is that we see that young girl, that 15-year-old girl mm-hmm. from the Rooster Project. She mm-hmm. comes up and she comes up to this young entrepreneur mm-hmm. where she hears about Hitsville and she wants to be a part of that. So we see that ambition from 15 all the way through when she becomes Diana.
Right.
And that's what I love about it, because it's not just a glimpse of, oh, this is when she was famous, but we see that journey of her discovering herself, learning about herself and how the group develops together and all the things and the tribulations and trials that they went through.
Sure.
You know, we see that journey and it's so gratifying.
Yeah, yeah. Stevie Wonder, similar kind of story, but this tremendous challenge that he has,
yeah.
The fact that he can't see. But again, one of the biggest stars in the world. Talk about playing that on stage.
It's so honoring, number one.
Yeah.
Just to play such a musical genius, who's actually, I can say, you know, one of the greats who, and he still creates and
yes.
still doing
amazing
things.
Oh
yes,
right?
Still touring and everything too. It's an honor to play him, and you know, every night I just pray that, as Mr. Gordy says, that people receive my truth.
Yeah.
In it, you know, there's a fine line that you have to walk with playing Stevie. You know, so it's not like you're making fun of him, but you're being true to, you know, something that he has that. You know, brings to
yeah.
his artistry and stuff. And in this show, with playing these characters, you see that these people, like she said, the journey,
yeah.
you see that they're humans.
Right,
like
right.
everyone else who worked, mm-hmm. who put in the work to become who they are.
Yeah, yeah. One of the great truths about Motown was the sort of interaction between the groups, the fact that it becomes like family over time. I would imagine that a Broadway show like this is sort of like that too,
yes.
right?
Absolutely.
There's a lot of... yeah,
absolutely, we are living together, you know, just like the Motown Review,
yeah.
where these groups were traveling together. I was talking to one of the singers from the Velvettes last night at yeah. the party. It was amazing. But she was telling me how when they were on the Dick Clark caravan, how they would sleep on the bus one night and then sleep in a hotel the next night. So there was a closeness
yeah, right.
that I feel that the traveling company definitely has. It does make us like family.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah, very much so. Like she said, with touring and everything, and actually having Berry Gordy and Smokey Robinson,
oh, right.
and, you know, Uncle Smokey and Uncle Berry,
right.
Papa Berry, you know, just having them there and being able to, the artists that are alive, to welcome us in.
Yeah.
You know, and, you know, when you come to the show, you'll see how we feel just as much yeah. as a part of the Motown family as they
yeah.
do.
I know that the thing about Motown music is that as soon as you hear those opening strains of one of those songs or the opening lines, there's this thing that wells up in your
Ooh,
gut.
Yeah.
I mean, this is an instant emotional response. I can't sing, so I have no experience of you know, trying to perform those, but I would imagine that performing those gives you even a different, a more intense, that emotional response to those notes, the way they come together. Talk about that. Just being on stage, singing these songs.
You know, we're helping people go down memory lane.
Mm-hmm.
And it's amazing when you sit there and I'm about to do Stevie and you hear a sign so delivered. I didn't even sing a note yet. And all I hear was dum, 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 dum. And there's one lady last night, she was like, oh my God, yes, he's singing it, he's singing it. And it's amazing. Like, it's one of the joys just being on that journey
that
with
charge,
them.
Right?
To help them remember where they were, who they were with, what they
the
were
first
eating.
First time you heard those
exactly.
Songs.
Absolutely.
And, and the first time you heard that song, too. And the thing about Motown, too, is that it not only was a music and a music sound, but it was a musical movement.
Yes.
That type of music reflected what was happening during the times, too.
Right.
And one of my favorite quotes from the show, Marvin Gaye says it. He says, I don't want to just reflect the times, man. I want to effect the times,
right.
You know?
Yeah.
And it's like that music went hand in hand with what was happening during the times, what's going on, ball of confusion, mm-hmm. specifically during the civil rights movement.
Sure.
And that's one thing that really is beautiful for me, because that music was very healing and expressive of what was happening.
Yeah.
And the fact, this is how you know that it's timeless music.
Mm-hmm.
Even then when it was created, it's still relevant now.
Right, everyone wants to hear it now. My kids are as into Motown as their grandmother was, who mm-hmm. went to high school with Diana Ross. So that's proof of the value of it.
Yeah.
So
mm-hmm.
Welcome to Detroit, and thanks for being here.
Thank you for having me.
Absolutely. All right, coming up next, details on a special event for Mental Health Awareness Month. But first, here's a 1990 Detroit Black Journal interview with Minister Razul Muhammad from the Nation of Islam.
Right now in the city of Detroit, we are now having plannings for halfway homes. We generally would call them FOI homes, where you take in the men and the women off the streets. It serves like a halfway home also for those coming out of prison. And it's not a permanent stay for them, but it is a place for them to get themselves back on track on their lives and also creating jobs. As usual, this is what the Nation of Islam for 60 years have stood for, independence. And when the men and the women see themselves doing things, progressing, establishing things in the city, they can look at and call their own because of they themselves doing this, then we believe that by that qualification for independence will make a better black male and female.
All right, May is Mental Health Awareness Month, and Detroit's Northeast Guidance Center is using it as an opportunity to draw attention to human trafficking. A special forum is going to focus on combating this growing crime right here in Metro Detroit. Here to tell us more is president of the Northeast Guidance Center, Sherry McCrill, along with Meredith Reese from Vista Maria and Dina Policcio from Alternatives for Girls. Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. All right. Let's start with you. Talk about this idea of human trafficking and Mental Health Awareness Month.
Mental Health Awareness Month is always in May, and this is a time where nationally we try to get out the anti-stigma messages that's so important for education. And this year, along with Community Network Services in Oakland County, we sponsor an anti-stigma event every May. So on May 4th from 5 to 8 at Northeast Guidance Center, we are going to be hosting our Mental Health Awareness Month on educating and combating human trafficking.
Yeah.
And our primary speaker is Teresa Flores, and she is a trafficking victim in the past who actually is from the Detroit metropolitan area.
Mm-hmm.
And she's going to be coming to talk about nationally and in Michigan what is happening with our movement and to try to educate folks, but also to talk about the SOAP project, which we're engaged in as well.
Yeah, talk about that SOAP project.
Well, the SOAP project is Save Our Adolescents from Prostitution. And this is a nationwide movement. Here in Michigan, there are several SOAP entities, one right in our area, which is Metro Detroit. And basically what we know over the last 5 to 10 years, and people have heard, is that when there are major events coming to urban cities such as Detroit, and by major events we're talking about when a lot of people are coming into town, like mm-hmm. for the auto show,
sure.
for the Grand Prix, not connected to those events, but people are using
there's a darker side.
A darker side,
yeah.
And there's vulnerable young women out there who are being brought in and trafficked.
Yeah.
One of the things that I found interesting also that I didn't know about is Michigan is a big hunting state up north. Mm-hmm. Little were we all aware that young gals are being put on buses
taken
in November
north,
and yeah. taken up north. Yeah. And trafficked as well. So the Silk Project has volunteers, and we have some through our agency as well. Mm-hmm. We get packaged soap, and our volunteers put on 3,000 bars of soap, the stickers that give the National Human Trafficking Hotline, as well as the statement about if you're being forced to do something that is not doesn't feel good to you or that you are being held, that this is the number to call and a volunteer will come and actually rescue you. So what the volunteers do is we put these stickers on. Then there's groups of people that before these large events visit major and not so major hotels yeah. and motels in Detroit, talk to the owners, show them the pictures of the young gals who are missing yeah. victims,
yeah.
as well as ask them, can we put these in all your restrooms?
Right, right. Dina and Meredith, and Dina, I'll apologize. I think I botched your name introducing your last name.
That's
okay. But Alternatives for Girls and Vista Maria are two organizations right on the front lines of this issue here in Southeast Michigan. Talk about the things that you guys are seeing with the growth, the unfortunate growth of human trafficking. Mm-hmm.
I think with Vista Maria, we've been around for over 130 years mm-hmm. providing treatment, care, education for vulnerable youth. And I think it's the growing awareness and discussion of this important topic of human trafficking
yeah.
and how we can best protect our children in our communities, but also to provide necessary interventions for those who are within the child welfare system, juvenile justice, and even outside of those systems
yeah.
And so forth.
Yeah. You guys are out in the communities looking for people who are caught up in these activities and giving them alternatives, right? Saying it doesn't have to be like this, we can do better.
Yes, Alternatives for Girls was actually founded around trying to keep girls who were forced into prostitution through their families, through poverty, through gangs. And we work to make sure that they have alternatives, of mm-hmm. course. Through Vista Maria, through Alternatives for Girls, we have different programs. We have a unique program for girls and women who have been in the life to get out and work their way through it. It's an untimed program because the trauma that's sustained is unlike any other trauma that we can see, because it's domestic violence, it's child abuse, it's rape,
yes.
and the mental trauma of all of those rolled into one experience and within one person, and along with societal stigma, societal backlash, societal turning their backs to
right.
these girls and women.
Yeah, I mean, that's one of the things that I find most confounding, really, about this issue is that the people who are caught in it are often blamed for what they're doing, as opposed to being seen as people who need help. And I would imagine a lot of your work is trying to turn that perception around, too.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. Yes, it is.
And I just would say, I mentioned girls and women, but this does happen to men.
It happens to men too.
Yes,
sure.
It does.
Yes.
And our LGBTQ population
exactly.
are exceptionally vulnerable, mm-hmm. especially because families force them out into the streets.
Sure.
And mm-hmm. allowing predators to find them and exploit individuals for their own gain.
Yeah.
And you mentioned an increase, Stephen. And it may be increasing, but what we know is for sure is the community is increasing awareness.
Is starting to talk
right.
more about
law
it.
Exactly.
enforcement has increased training, mm-hmm. so identification is happening more.
I see.
This has been part of our community
right.
for the beginning of time. Or
forever, sure.
And so identification is increasing. Services mm-hmm. have been there forever are increasing
right.
because people are being found and
yeah.
self-identifying too. Also, this has happened mm-hmm. to them when they were children as adults.
Right.
And they're saying, that's what happened to me. I can get services. I'm not alone.
Right. Yeah.
And
yeah.
I think it's also important with the services that are offered with the mental health treatment, which is right in line with Mental Health Awareness Month mm-hmm. here in May and beyond,
mm-hmm.
with not only with the providing the treatment, but again, with the awareness within the community, but how can the community can help?
Right. How
and
can
I think
you
that's a conversation
see, especially
to expand.
If you see something, say something.
See
that
something,
is always
something.
The thing that.
And we have to be ready to have the difficult conversations around demand.
Yes.
Yes.
Because
that's right.
this does not happen. Nobody is sold if nobody is buying
it. If no one were buying it in the first place.
Yeah. Yes. So we have to talk about the mental health issues that go behind
the demand,
not just the victimization.
Absolutely.
Exactly.
We could go on for hours.
We can.
No, but we are out of time. I want to thank you all for being here, and congratulations on the event.
Thank you.
Absolutely. All right, that's our program for today. Thanks for watching. You can get more information about our guests at AmericanBlackJournal.org, and you can always connect with us on Facebook and on Twitter. We'll see you next time.
American Black Journal is funded by the W.K. Kellogg Foundation, a partner with communities where children come first.
How does diversity bring energy to us all? At DTE Energy, we believe that it's the contributions of all that build great communities. As a company, we grow stronger by welcoming the unique perspectives of everyone. As community members, we support our state's broad culture and heritage. From working closely with women and minority-owned suppliers to embracing our local cultures, DTE Energy is powering diversity. The DTE Energy Foundation is a proud sponsor of Detroit Public Television. Masco Corporation is proud to manufacture innovative and environmentally friendly products for the home. Delta Faucets, Craft Made in Maryland Cabinets, and Bear Brand Paints have all been designed with you in mind. Masco and its family of companies, serving Michigan communities since 1929.